Confucius, Confucius, Sigmund Freud, and Farah Muhammad. Is it evolution or God? Searching for the truth is a threat. Seems the closer we get to the truth, state troopers offense. Come out to silence you. My house in Malibu, probably tap, cause living next door to Demi Moore. Plus I'm black, plus I want vengeance for the poor who's attacked daily. Patriot Act never scared me. Jake in the Taurus, sticky in the Jarvis. Wake got warrants, America's browning. 20 years from now, every town will be brown and Latin. An African looking Manhattan. I'ma tell you what I seen with my three eyes. Word to me, not a hoax back in 99. A spacecraft in the skyline. In LA in daytime, ask horse if I'm lying.
Every mother, every father, raise your sons and your daughters with respect and with honor. From the seed comes the fruit. It's an unbroken circle. All of life is universal, and we're all in the struggle. If I know one thing is true, we're not.
Evidence remains in debate. Documents of our own Air Force base. Additional terrestrial information. Other planets with life population. My observation. Scientists study pictures of a flying disc. Right on Earth, anthropologists.
Welcome. You have entered the zone of high strangeness. A place where the unbelievable is believed until proven otherwise. I'm your host, Gary Wheeler, and it's another beautiful day in Rockland. And we have a good show for you this afternoon. As you probably recognize, the theme is a song called, a rap song called We Are Not Alone by a group named Nas. Apparently the lead singer and writer of the song had a UFO experience in Los Angeles and wrote this song after he had that event, which was pretty meaningful to him, I believe. This evening, excuse me, pardon me, we have a cold situation here. The callers are welcome this afternoon, and the number here is 207-593-0013. And, of course, callers are welcome who have any interest in this topic at all, and especially if you've had a personal experience or know have somebody who has and you can relate their story, or you just want to express an opinion about the subject. A little FYI, again, I'll announce there's a conference that's taking place in May, from May 25th to 31st in 2015 at Joshua Tree Park in California. It's going to be a UFO conference with all the heavyweights will be there, all the people that have been involved in this field for years and years making presentations. So if you feel like taking a trip and want to get where it's warm, that would be a good one to take. And so that's May 25th to the 31st. And if you wish to get more information on the website is contactinthedesert.com. That's again, contactinthedesert.com. Again, I'll remind you about your digital cameras. If you're taking outside pictures and you get some pictures of sky shots, take a good look at them after you print them. You may see things that you didn't see when you were taking the picture because those cameras have the ability to pick up some frequencies beyond what our eyes can pick up, especially in the infrared zone and the ultraviolet zone frequencies. So, you know, pay close attention. You may pick up something that would be of interest. It just might be a UFO. Who knows? I want to thank my sponsors, Diverse Landscapes here in Rockland, and Eric Best, who's an author and business consultant and good friend. Again, I'll remind you, you're listening to WRFR, 93.3 FM in Rockland, and 99.3 in Camden. Also, we're streaming on WRFR.org, and there's also podcasts available of past shows as well on the website. This afternoon, we're going to have an audio of the ex-Secretary of Defense for Canada, Paul Hellyer, who's retired now, but he was equivalent of our Secretary of Defense in Canada in the early 90s. And his particular experience and his devotion to getting out information about what's going on in this country with the UFO issues, as well as with the kind of shadow government that he believes is actually exists, and that there's a small group of individuals who are controlling the flow of money around the world, and that they're the ones who are basically calling the shots. And they're also the ones who are basically hindering any kind of disclosure about the whole UFO issue from coming to light. So this will be about a 25-minute audio of him giving a presentation. Now, he just made this presentation just the last month, so it's pretty recent, and he has a sense of being wanting to get this information out as quickly as possible, because he's getting older, and he wants people to become aware of what's going on so that they can start taking action, because he believes we're running into a very critical stage that changes have to be made. So I'm going to put that on now, and I'll be back in about 20 minutes. And as I say, callers are welcome. Best if you call during break time, which should be around 4:30, or at the end of the show. But any time is fine as well. Okay, I'll put this on now. Paul Hellyer.
My name is Paul Hellyer, and I am a former Minister of National Defense for Canada. This disturbing message is for the several million Americans and others who were kind enough to listen to the 22-minute presentation at the Citizens Disclosure hearing in Washington in May 2013, and for anyone else who cares deeply about the future of their country and the planet Earth. The U.S. is in grave danger. Strangely, the peril is not from foreign enemies, but from enemies within. So I beg you to listen to a summary of the major problems, followed by some suggestions as to how the U.S. might be recaptured by loyal Americans, to the enormous relief of friends who have been watching helplessly from the sidelines. The stakes couldn't be higher. So I spent the 15 months following the Washington hearing feverishly writing a new book, incorporating what I think every American has the right to know and must know to end the incredible naivety observed at the citizens' hearing. The name of the book is The Money Mafia, A World in Crisis. Most of my friends, both American and Canadian, tend to agree that the world is in a state of crisis. But very few are aware that the problems are not natural phenomena. They have been engineered by a very tiny elite group of rich, ruthless, and power-hungry people who have been deliberately keeping the majority of decent, hard-working taxpayers totally in the dark. The Iron Veil of Secrecy is now nearing the end of its seventh decade. When World War II ended, little attention was given to Operation Paperclip, under which hundreds of Nazi scientists were brought to the U.S., given new identities, and then appointed to important jobs in the military and elsewhere. Some of them would have been aware of UFOs and the ET presence from their experience in working with them in the 1930s. The American military began to take the subject more seriously after retrieving one of the vehicles that crashed near Roswell, New Mexico, on July 4, 1947, and decided to back-engineer its technology, which was light years more advanced than anything that we had known. On Tuesday, July 8, 1947, at 11 a.m. Mountain Time, Roswell Air Field Commanding Officer Colonel William Blanchard announced in a press release the recovery of a flying disc. That was the truth. Later that same day, at approximately 4:30 p.m. Central Time, Brigadier General Roger Ramey, commander of the 8th Air Force and Blanchard's supervising officer, presented to the press an alternative story. He claimed the Army had recovered a Rawan target device suspended by a neoprene balloon. That was a lie. In fact, it was the cornerstone lie of what was to become a cult of lying and disinformation that is still United States policy today, 68 years later. In my brief address to the Citizens Disclosure hearing, I said that the United States and much of the Western world is ultimately controlled by an unelected, unaccountable cabal. Its apex is the banking and financial cartel, followed by the oil cartel, the CEOs of the largest and most powerful transnational corporations, major intelligence agencies, including the CIA, the FBI, and the NSA, and a major slice of the U.S. military. Their collective power and influence is incalculable. And it is their plan for the U.S. and the rest of us that is so alarming. Their plan is an empire greater in size and power than any empire before it. They call this the New World Order, which, ironically, is the same name Hitler used for the smaller empire he imagined. One sure thing, the New World Order will end all pretense of government of, by, and for the people. It will be a dictatorship of, by, and for a small minority of the rich and privileged elite. Much of its power lies in the privately owned banking system. Why monarchs and politicians allowed a private cartel to become the monopoly supplier of new money, we will never know. But this power is almost absolute and can determine the fate of nations and their people. A system where nearly all money is created as debt, and debt that has to be repaid with interest, but where no one creates any money with which to pay the interest, is a dead end that leaves debtors with no alternative but to borrow the money to pay the interest and go deeper and deeper into debt. It's so wildly absurd that a grade 10 student would only need a few minutes to recognize it as one giant Ponzi scheme. Banks can invest $5 million and leverage it to create $100 million in loans that have to be repaid with interest. In effect, they skim 95% off the top of every loan. That is the reason I call them the money mafia. Monetary reform is the most urgent of all essential reforms, and my book contains a specific formula that the brave Occupy Wall Street protesters could have used to advantage when asked, "But what do you suggest?" What they lacked was the answer to that question. If about 99% of the population don't understand a deception that has been responsible for the Great Depression of the 1930s, the terrible recessions of 1981, 82, 1991, and the Great Recession of the 21st century, it's not too difficult to understand why there are so many skeptics about UFOs and their occupants, even though several species have been visiting planet Earth for thousands of years. The crashes near Roswell, New Mexico, that I referred to earlier, were, in a sense, watershed events. In Canada, Wilbert Smith, a senior officer in our Federal Department of Transport, of which I later became minister, wrote a top-secret memorandum to his boss based on information he had received during a visit to our embassy in Washington. The memo, dated November 21st, 1950, read in part as follows. A. The matter is the most highly classified subject in the United States, reading higher even than the H-bomb. B. Flying saucers exist. See, their modus operandi is unknown, but concentrated effort is being made by a small group headed by Dr. Vannevar Bush. D, the entire matter is considered by the United States authorities to be of tremendous significance. A control group of 12 senior civilian scientists and military officers was established by President Truman. They were known as the Majestic 12, or MJ-12, which issued a memorandum that included how to respond to UFO sightings by saying that they were natural phenomena, such as plasma or swamp gas, or that the observer might have been imbibing too much Jack Daniel's bourbon. Nothing could be further from the truth. Under the Eisenhower administration, much of the physical engineering was transferred to underground facilities in Nevada and Arizona. Meanwhile, much of the control was transferred to civilian agencies in order to create plausible deniability as to its existence. When President Eisenhower wanted to take a look at the restricted areas, he was denied access. It was only when he threatened to send in the First Army that it was agreed that he could send three confidants to look at the secret areas, 51 and S4. They reported that the Roswell vehicle was indeed being back-engineered by United States forces. President Eisenhower was so distressed by the situation that he included in his farewell address to the nation that his fellow Americans should beware of the military-industrial complex, which, according to one witness, was his way of saying that the ET file had fallen into the wrong hands. Indeed it had. It was under the control of the military-industrial complex, otherwise known as the financial, intelligence, and military wing of the all-pervasive cabal, which has seized control of the United States and much of the balance of the world. Beginning with Eisenhower, not one of the presidents of the United States has been given completely honest advice by his civil, military, and intelligence advisors, nor fully briefed on the ET presence and technology. The military-industrial complex adopted a strategy of perpetual warfare to enhance its own power and profit. It is inconceivable that this plan was discussed and approved in advance by any American president. Wernher von Braun, the German rocket scientist who came to the U.S. at the end of World War II, told my friend Dr. Carol Rosen, who worked with him, that they, the military-industrial complex, in order to maintain perpetual war, had to have an enemy. First, it will be the communists, he said. Then it will be the terrorists. And finally, it will be the ETs. So far, the plan has been unfolding exactly as forecast. The cabal, sometimes referred to as the shadow government, has been in control. When Sarah McClendon, veteran White House reporter, asked President Bill Clinton why he didn't do something about UFO disclosure, Clinton replied, and I quote, "Sarah, there's a government inside the government, and I don't control it." End of quote. Imagine the President of the United States and Commander-in-Chief of the Armed Forces isn't cleared to know what his troops are doing. Well, with the end of the Cold War, the Pentagon wrote a new defense plan, popularly known as a Project for the New American Century. It was very far-reaching and involved conquest of much of the world by financial or military means, whichever was easiest. The document, which very few people were aware of, admitted that it was so far-reaching that it might be too much for Americans to swallow, in the absence of some catastrophic and catalyzing event like a new Pearl Harbor. Well, Lady Luck appeared to be on their side in the form of September the 11th, 2001. Amateur foreign pilots trained in the U.S. allegedly hijacked planes and flew them into the sides of the World Trade Towers 1 and 2, and then into the Pentagon. Later in the day, the buildings collapsed. President Bush declared war on the terrorists and invoked the provisions in the North Atlantic Treaty, under which an attack on any one country is considered to be an attack on all. The reaction was unprecedented since the outbreak of World War II and the later attack on Pearl Harbor. The English-speaking world in particular was incensed, and a high percentage of Americans were prepared to nuke the perpetrators. Defense Secretary Donald Rumsfeld soon announced that, quote, that means war against Iraq, end of quote, even though there was absolutely no evidence of Iraqi complicity, none whatsoever. Although most Muslims had been sympathetic to the U.S. in the immediate aftermath of 9/11, as soon as the bombs started dropping on Baghdad, moderate Muslims by the thousand were so outraged and overcome by hate that they opted for a terrorist response. From that day on, it would be difficult to find a terrorist who did not have "Made in the USA" etched on his or her soul. Now, more than a decade later, the situation becomes even darker as the truth about 9/11 begins to emerge from the burial ground of a controlled press. We find that high officials in the George W. Bush administration knew of the attack weeks in advance and made no effort to prevent it. On the contrary, the evidence points to complicity when we find that not just two, nor three, buildings collapsed, nor four, nor five, nor six, but seven. Some, if not all, had been rigged for controlled demolition. But that isn't all. A new weapon of mass destruction was used that reduced the concrete and steel to dust before it reached the ground. If you have any doubts about this, get a copy of Dr. Judy Wood's book entitled "Where Did the Towers Go?"
I'm going to interrupt for a second and just remind you, you're listening to WRFR 93.3 FM in Rockland and 99.3 in Camden. And this is Gary Wheeler, your host of the show High Strangeness. Remind you, you're listening to Paul Hallier, ex Secretary of Defense for Canada, giving a talk actually last month on what he believes is an emergency kind of issue that the people of the United States have to face, what's going on with our shadow government and the secrecy behind the hiding the UFO issue. Hallier is well-respected. He became involved with the UFO issue. Just a second. I believe I have a phone call coming in. I'll answer it. Hello, you're on WRFR. Hello, you're on WRFR. Hello. Hello, you're on WRFR. Oops, sorry, no connection. To continue that, he was basically giving information about Philip Corso's book called The Day After Roswell. It had a lot of information about the Roswell crash and the reverse engineering of the technology that was found on that vehicle. And he was skeptical about it. He got this information from Philip Corso's book. And because of his contacts, having been the Secretary of Defense for Canada, he could check with a lot of the generals and people high up in the U.S. military about the information in that book. And they all said that it was basically true. So he had the right kind of information to get it from the right people. Okay, I'm going to put the tape back on again. And sorry, caller, I can't seem to get the call board to work. Okay, here we go. We'll continue.
500 pages of meticulous evidence. The unfolding story reveals the greatest mass deception in history, with the most universally negative consequences. Far more important than the long lineups for security checks at airports, we have been stripped of our civil rights one by one, including, I regret to say, habeas corpus, reversing 800 years of progress. Country was set against country, religion against religion. Words like peace and negotiated settlement, which had been possibilities before 9/11, were lost in the jungle of lies. The cabal, also known as the military-industrial complex, was not interested in a just settlement. It wanted perpetual war, and that was what its heinous deception achieved. It also robbed the once great United States of America of its last vestige of moral leadership. Worse, by invoking NATO, it transformed a defense alliance into a U.S.-led task force. And by recruiting former countries from the Soviet Union, an obvious provocation to Russia, it has managed to create rumblings of a new Cold War. The danger lies in the fact that the New World Order is not limited to old boundaries and concepts of empire, and we seem hell-bent toward a Third World War, horrible beyond human imagination. It must not be allowed to happen. Almost every president since Eisenhower has been under the control of the cabal, and President Obama, regrettably, has been no exception. Before he was sworn in as a new president, I saw a picture of his economic advisors, and I said, uh-oh, the same old gang who permitted the Bush recession. Nothing will change. Then when the president persuaded innocent allies to join in a second unwinnable war in Iraq, and a senior U.S. military commander confirmed that it would take several years to win, it was obvious that President Obama was playing the military-industrial alliance game, and that it would be the only winner. Extreme Islam is an ideology, and it can't be killed by smart bombs. Most ISIS recruits begin as young idealists who are repelled by the way the world is being run and are looking for a better way. Any effective strategy must be to win their hearts and minds and not just to kill them and make them martyrs to a cause. Step number one is to convince President Obama that the policies of his predecessor benefit no one but the arms manufacturers. So all non-Muslim members of the coalition should withdraw from the war against the Islamic State and begin to reverse all of the wrongs committed by the West in recent years. Hate him or love him, President Obama is the only person in the world with the power to lead a penitent United States and its misled allies in the moral and spiritual revolution essential for a world of peace and justice, where the human species has a fighting chance to survive. The transformation has to be reversible before the next U.S. presidential election, which could be the point of no return. Ultimately, the Muslims must be allowed to settle their own problems. Before 9/11, Iraq was a Sunni dictatorship that treated its Shia brothers and sisters badly. The U.S. deposed Saddam Hussein and established a new Shia majority that treated a Sunni minority unfairly. The seeds of further conflict were born. The Muslims must resolve their age-long differences as Christians and of different denominations have recently been able to do. Perhaps the United Nations might be invited by the Muslims to convene a meeting of both temporal and religious leaders in search of a better way of settling grievances and differences. Meanwhile, it's time that all the Abrahamic religions, Christianity, Judaism, and Islam, kissed and made up. I was in my 80s before I knew that Allah was my God. My guess is that the majority of Christians are equally ill-informed, and the Israelites should start treating Palestinians as the blood brothers that they really are, instead of as inferior beings. It is wise to remember that the original covenant with the Creator applied to all of Abraham's children, and not just to the favored few. The bottom line is that the use of drones, suicide bombs, and crushing military superiority on the part of Christians, Muslims, and Jews are all prohibited by their holy books. The next step is to persuade all the major religions to practice the one principle that they have in common, which is to treat others the way they would want to be treated if the roles were reversed. Universal practice of the Golden Rule would transform the world. I get hundreds of emails from decent Americans and like-minded individuals in a dozen countries who want nothing more than the end of militarism and a massive shift in priorities toward universal peace and justice. Quite a few are involved in small projects that are making a significant difference at the micro level. But most of them are realists and recognize that the cabal doesn't want peace and justice. It wants power, wealth, and empire. So what can an individual do in the face of unprecedented power and wealth? The cabal, headed by the banking cartel, has almost unlimited financial power. But we the people have the numbers and must combine our limited power to form a critical mass that can move mountains. There is no guaranteed formula, but an educated guess would be that if 5 million decent and determined Americans got a copy of The Money Mafia, A World in Crisis, read it carefully, and then actively supported the comprehensive action plan set out in it, a miracle could happen. Each one of the 5 million would have to write a personal letter to the president, their senator, and their congressperson, demanding action forthwith and each of the critical areas in the same spirit of bipartisanship that would be expected in a war to save the world, which is exactly what is at stake. I am not going to repeat the list of essential reforms here, except for a few key items. The U.S. should play a leadership role in ending the private bankers' monopoly to print money. Actually, it isn't really money, it's just credit created out of thin air, a computer entry, and restore some of the power to the people that is rightfully theirs. President Obama can mint $2 trillion platinum coins to get the ball rolling, while legislation is prepared to take over the Fed and establish a 100% publicly owned central bank. A central bank of the United States. There cannot and will not be peace and justice on earth while the Fed continues to exist. Speaking of justice, if President Obama really wants a place in history as a friend of the 99% rather than the 1%, he can fast-track the Trans-Pacific Partnership into oblivion. Even the name is a lie. There is no way it is a partnership. It should be called the Trans-Pacific Power Grab by a small elite group who want to feather their own nests at the expense of other people's rights to run their own affairs for their own benefit. So the choice is yours, Mr. President, to decide if it will be the people or the cabal. There must be full disclosure of what the cabal and the U.S. shadow government have been doing since World War II. To what extent has the extraterrestrial space and weapons technology been back-engineered? And is it true, as the late Ben Rich, former CEO of Lockheed's Skunk Works, said, and I quote, "We, the U.S., now have the technology to take E.T. home," end of quote. The extent to which there has been collaboration between the cabal and the ETs. What species? What motives? Were there agreements signed? And if so, were the terms of the treaty or treaties lived up to? To hear the truth emerge after so many years of continual lies and darkness will require either that the National Security Act of 1947 be rescinded or suspended, with a general amnesty so that decent Americans can tell the truth without fear of retribution. A kind of truth and reconciliation process will be required. Then there are the positive benefits that must be pursued. The president must issue an order that would release the secret patents on exotic energy and make them available to the world. The secret technology, in combination with a flexible financial system, will make it possible to convert from an oil economy to a clean economy in 7 years. It will provide billions of new jobs worldwide and help close the ever-widening gap between the haves and the have-nots. Simultaneously, a project should be started to restore our oceans before the food chain has been permanently broken. In addition, worldwide programs of forest preservation and reforestation should help provide the carbon sinks essential for greater stability in weather patterns. Speaking of changing weather patterns, full disclosure should give us a better idea of how much weather patterns have been altered by government tinkering. Due to restraints of time, space, and expertise, my book makes no mention of either chemtrails or the high-frequency active auroral research program known as HAARP. But from what I have heard and read from credible informants, I would say that they are Satan's illegitimate Siamese twins of death and destruction. If so, they should be terminated at once and relegated to the netherworld from which they came, and before the people of the world become aware and launch a $10 or $20 trillion class action suit against the United States Air Force, its contractors, associates, and suppliers. A visit to the battlefields of World Wars I and II in November of last year affected me profoundly. The slogans were everywhere: "Never again." We had seen the horror of man's inhumanity to man, which was sordid beyond belief. Yet as I reflected on the real world of today, I thought that the millions who gave their lives had died in vain. Even before the Second World War was over, a group of greedy, self-centered men were plotting the next round, and they have been working assiduously at their plan. The same symptoms of mass unemployment, poverty, and seeking military advantage have been replicated. But the next time, we would start off with weapons of mass destruction just in their infancy then. The next time, it is not just supremacy that is at stake, although there are some who think so. It is the survival of the human species that is at stake. God will not be mocked. We have been given the choice of making our planet uninhabitable, as we have been told some other species have done. Or we can move in the opposite direction of peace, love, justice, and cooperation for the betterment of all, rich and poor alike. We have been given a few months, not years, to change course before it is too late. The choice is ours. We are the ones who are destined to write our own history.
Well, you've been listening to Paul Hellyer, doing the town crier, saying that we better wake up. It's a wake-up call, and a call to action, actually, because, as he says so succinctly, the time is definitely running out, and we need to take action, although the list of problems he gives has, seems almost insurmountable based on our turtle-like progress that we seem to make when it comes to any real change. It just seems to take forever to turn the ship around. And I don't see how it's really going to happen unless we have some external help. And by that, I mean external help from the ETs who can wake us up just by showing up and letting us know that there's something much larger going on than just our own egos that need to be dealt with. So I think it's a very interesting talk by him, and one that should be shared. It's available on YouTube if you go there and just put in Paul Hellyer's name and put in a disclosure. It will pop up. And actually, I'm in the middle of reading his book, The Money Mafia, the most recent book which he speaks of. And it's a very informative book. And you learn a lot just about the existence of these other secretive institutions that are pulling the strings with the money. And you know the old phrase, follow the money, and that's going to take you where the power exists. So, well worthwhile, and I thank Paul Hellyer for putting himself on the line like that. He takes a lot of heat, I'm sure, from other politicians and such who want this information not to be taken seriously, and just make fun of him for being an old man who's paranoid, which I think is very far from the truth. Now, somebody else who certainly agrees with Paul Hellyer, especially around the cabal or the shadow government, is the UFO historian Richard Dolan, and who's done a lot of work in this area and has written several books about the cover-up by the national security state and the cover-up of UFOs and the UFO history that's happened, especially since Roswell in the 40s, the crash of the UFO. So I'm going to play his audio, which I played before, but I always feel is worth repeating, which is his 10-minute summation of the cover-up since Roswell, and how the national security state has basically kept all the information about UFOs from the public. So I'm going to play that, and then we'll discuss it a little more. Here we go.
Hello, I'm Richard Dolan. I'm an author and historian on the topic of UFOs. Today I've got a treat for you. The UFO cover-up in 10 minutes. UFO cover-up? Preposterous, you say? Guess again. That might have been an argument people could make 20, maybe 30, maybe 50 years ago. We now know, beyond a shadow of a doubt, that the UFO problem engaged the attention of some very, very high-level people throughout every single decade of this nation's history, from World War II onward. But we didn't know for sure until the mid-1970s, when we had a Freedom of Information Act that finally got some teeth in the United States. The big surprise about Freedom of Information was the fact that UFO researchers started to petition and receive thousands of pages of UFO-related documents from their government. I want to read to you a couple of choice excerpts from some of these documents that we now have in the public domain. Here's a great one. 1947, September 23rd, from U.S. General Nathan Twining, a three-star general at the time. He later went on to be a four-star general and chief of staff for the United States Air Force. It is the opinion that the phenomenon reported is something real and not visionary or fictitious. The reported operating characteristics, such as extreme rates of climb, maneuverability, particularly in roll, and action which must be considered evasive when sighted, lend belief to the possibility that some of the objects are controlled either manually, automatically, or remotely. He describes six common characteristics that military observers were reporting about these objects. Metallic or light reflecting surface. Circular or elliptical in shape, flat on bottom and domed on top. Ask yourself, what kind of aircraft in 1947 is flying around that's supposed to look like that? Here's another memo from the FBI, 1949. Officers of G2, that's Army Intelligence, have discussed the matter of unidentified aircraft, otherwise known as flying discs, flying saucers, balls of fire. This matter is considered top secret by intelligence officers of both the Army and the Air Forces. Oh, this is a great one. 1951 Robins Air Force Base out of Georgia. A pilot flying out of the base reported an object fly by his aircraft. Object described as flat on top and bottom and appearing from a front view to have rounded edges and slightly beveled. What? One of the interesting things about the UFOs in the history of this country, 1952, a very big year. Why? Well, for one, it seemed like the entire nation was being invaded by UFOs. Civilians and military people alike around the country were watching these things. Military people reported them a lot. This is a memo from the Director of Scientific Intelligence for the CIA to the Director of the agency, Walter Beadle Smith, in December 1952, and this is what it says. At this time, the reports of incidents convince us that there is something going on that must have immediate attention. Sightings of unexplained objects at great altitudes and traveling at high speeds in the vicinity of major U.S. defense installations are of such nature that they are not attributable to natural phenomena or known types of aerial vehicle. It's the CIA. People don't just come out and say, boss, I think we're being invaded. But that's about as close as you're going to get in a classified memo to the director of the Central Intelligence Agency in 1952. It gets better. This is a document from 1976. United States Defense Intelligence Agency reporting about an amazing UFO encounter over the city of Tehran in Iran. Now remember, this is back in the days of the Shah when Iran was a key U.S. ally. What happened is that on September 18, 1976, citizens of Tehran looked up in the sky and saw a very bizarre object. No one knew what it was. An extremely bright, unidentified flying object. Finally, the traffic controller went out and looked and saw, sure enough, a very bizarre object. He called the Iranian Air Force. Next thing you know, not one but two F-4 fighter jets are scrambled to investigate and intercept the object. In both cases, in succession, each F-4 jet got within 25 nautical miles of the object. The pilots saw the object. They tracked it on radar. It gave a very large radar return. And in both cases, key electronics and aviation equipment went offline on these top-level aircraft. Not once, but twice. In the second instance, a really extraordinary encounter occurred when this object detached a smaller object from it, which then pursued the F-4 interceptor. The pilot pulled an extreme turn to get away from the object, and this small object turned inside his own arc and then rejoined the mothercraft for a perfect rejoin. That's 1976. What can do that today, much less 35 years ago? Well, officially speaking, we don't really know. Unofficially, I think we do know. These are advanced technology that is not being operated, officially at least, by our own civilization. And therein lies the problem with the UFO phenomenon. Everyone in the world knows there's something going on, and no one in official power is ever willing to admit it. There are people who are so high bound in their opinions and so skeptical about this without bothering to look at any of the evidence that they will say, Well, the government did look into this. The government did have Project Blue Book. They investigated it. They found there was really nothing to this. I heard that there was a scientific investigation, too, that also debunked UFOs. That explanation to this day is used by the Air Force and by the government to dismiss the whole topic of UFOs. But here's the deal. Project Blue Book, a joke of an operation. I have a letter here from 1955 to the commander at Ent Air Force Base in Colorado Springs, Colorado, about UFO reports. In keeping with the purposes of the UFOB program, in this case UFOB means UFO, it is necessary to strive to reach as many case solutions as possible, thereby reducing the percentage of unknowns to a bare minimum. Not a minimum, a bare minimum. As pointed out in the UFOB guide, the word solution cannot always be used in the scientific sense when dealing with UFOBs. For this purpose, it must more often mean that a given case meets a given hypothesis. If it looks like it might be a flock of birds, you don't have to bother investigating. Just put down birds and it's solved. Here's a picture of the Blue Book staff in the early to mid-1960s. Do they inspire your confidence? What I'm really digging is the poster in the back of the solar system. Yeah, that'll help investigate UFO cases. And we're told that they investigated a total of 12,618 sightings, and only 701 remained unidentified. Look, I'll tell you right now, those people didn't do one investigation that was worth a damn. And then there's the study of UFOs by the University of Colorado back in the 1960s, otherwise known as the Condon Committee. There's a picture of Edward Condon. You can see how seriously he takes the topic of UFOs. The funny thing about the Condon Committee report is that the scientists who were involved in it began to suspect that this was a rigged game right from the beginning. A few of them confronted Condon about this, in which he admitted to them that, yes, there was not going to be an affirmative conclusion coming out of this report, no matter what. Shortly after that, there was a mutiny on the project, and half the scientific members were thrown right off the Condon Committee. Another group was scrabbled together. They threw together the big report, in which, amazingly anyway, 30% of those were unidentified cases. And what was the conclusion? Edward Condon told you, keep things moving along, people. Nothing to see here. That is the scientific foundation, if you can believe it, as to why your government continues to this day to deny that there is a UFO reality worth investigating, to which we say, one more thing for fun that we could look at. Let's fast forward to 1997. Here's a U.S. Air Force general telling you exactly what happened in Roswell in 1947.
That period of time, dummies were dropped all around there. And I think it's logical that, to assume that the people there saw Air Force ambulances come out, they saw gurneys come out, they saw body bags come out because the dummies were put into body bags to protect them.
We all kind of know what an alien's supposed to look like, and that doesn't look like an alien to me. If you really think you're going to be confused by a 6-foot dummy, then you're a dummy. There's something happening that's beyond our current capabilities that might be a problem to explain to the world. The problem with that, however, is that the world is moving along a little too fast. The UFO secrecy, very soon, is going to be a thing of the past. Thanks for listening. Catch you next time.
Okay, that was Richard Dolan doing his high-speed synopsis of the UFO cover-up since Roswell back in the 1940s. Actually, a pretty complete list, but I would recommend getting his books. He has 4 books, basically divided up by years, going into detail about the UFO cover-up and how the government got away with what it's gotten away with right to this time. So that was a lot of information to throw at you, and again, I encourage you to go to YouTube and put these gentlemen's names in, Paul Hellyer, as well as Richard Dolan, and look at more of what they have to say. It's a fascinating topic, and these people are kind of putting themselves out there to kind of try to wake everybody up and say, look, you know, this is happening, and we're running out of time for ourselves as far as what we need to do here on this beautiful planet of ours, and that the reality is we need help. We need help to get through this difficult time, and it's about time we start asking for help in a way that is non-threatening, and it shows a level of respect that we can have for other beings in this universe. So I'm going to sign off now and wish you all a good week. I'll see you next Sunday. And as always, embrace the mystery, and especially embrace the mystery that is you. Till next week.